Get your SISM training from Thor Peterson.
Let's start out by taking a look at the CIA triad. And I will call it the CIA triad throughout this course. If you're taking other courses, you may see it as the AIC triad, but I will trust in your ability to know when I'm talking about the CIA triad or the Central Intelligence Agency. The one time that I will talk about the CIA, and it is the agency, I will let you know. The CIA triad consists of three things. As you can see over here on the right, it's confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And confidentiality is what most people think IT security is, but it is much, much more. Confidentiality is us keeping our secret secret, and we ensure that only people who are authorized to access the data can access it. And then we have integrity. How do we make sure that our data is not modified without our knowing? And the confidentiality and the integrity are closely tied together. And as the third leg of the triad, we have availability. This is where we make sure that the authorized people who needs to access the data can access it when they need it. And how I just said that this is the foundation, well, the CIA triad is the foundation of the foundation, or we can use it as the foundation anchors. This is what everything ties back to. And how much of each of these we need depends on what we're protecting and our business. If it's our web server, then availability and integrity are probably most important. If it is a payment platform on our website, well, then confidentiality and integrity might be more important. So depending on what we're protecting, we need the right mix for that data. Let's take a deeper look at each of these three, starting with confidentiality. And you have probably seen many of the same movies that I have, where data is compromised and it's by some super hacker. Where in most cases, that's not what happens in the real world. It can just as easy be users making mistakes, admins, customers, or it could be attackers. But for us, in most cases, it doesn't really matter how our confidentiality is breached, because it is. Because our data is just as compromised, regardless if it's a user that shares the data with a competitor or it's a super complex hack. We're still compromised. And these over here are some of the common threats that we have to our confidentiality. One of them is attacks on our encryption or cryptanalysis. While it is doable, it is very, very difficult to crack encryption today without there being some flaw in it. Because the encryption is so strong, unless they can find a side channel, it is very difficult to crack encryption, which then brings us to the next one, social engineering. It is much easier to get someone else to give you the password to the server than it is to try to break it. And all of these threats we're going to go a lot more in depth with later in this course. It could also be keyloggers. Either some employee could have visited a compromised website that installed a keylogger on their system, and now everything they type is reported back to whoever that attacker is. It could also be the Internet of Things. It is awesome to have so many things connected to the network so you can control them from anywhere, but it is also a huge security risk. Many of them are on the regular network where they should not be, and most of them are never patched and never updated. So an attacker might be able to hack into a smart TV in the conference room and from that launch an attack on the network. So to protect against all these bad things, let's look at what we do with the three different types of data. We have data at rest, that's data sitting on disk somewhere, not being used. We have data in motion, that's data traversing the network. And then we have data in use, that's actively being used on a workstation or a server. For data at rest, we encrypt it, we have encryption on everything. It's just sitting there, not doing anything, and it is much safer if it is encrypted. Obviously, we only encrypt things that matter. But in many corporate environments, that's a lot of stuff. That could be us having AES-256 full disk encryption for all workstations. Whenever you log into the computer and you start using it every morning, it decrypts the hard drive. If we have things that are more sensitive, then we have stronger encryption. But again, it is data at rest. With data in motion, we secure the transport protocols that we use to send the data, and most of that often is end-to-end encryption. If you go to Amazon to buy something, well, when that connection is secure, your browsing is seen by you and by Amazon. The same when you buy something. Again, a secure connection. If you are on your work network and you need to access some server that has some critical information, your transport from the data from the server to your workstation should be secured. It should be encrypted from end to end. Which then brings us to the more difficult one, data in use. It's not sitting on a server somewhere. It's not being sent. We're actively using it, meaning we cannot use encryption. So what do we do here? And here it's really more about training and policies and awareness. We might have a clean desk policy, meaning you can't have anything printed out on your desk unless you're actively using it right now. If you move away from your desk, well, then you either lock it away or you need to shred it. And the thing here about data in use, it's not just stuff on a computer. A printout is still data. If you have 500 account numbers or social security numbers and that gets stolen, that's bad. So we can have the clean desk policies. We can have policies on shoulder surfing. No one is allowed to stand behind any employee's workstation while they're working. We can have view angle protectors. It's a little film you put over your screen, and anyone not sitting right in front of the monitor can see what's on the screen. Or the PC locks, where if you're not doing anything actively for a minute or whatever amount of time, then the PC will lock on its own. Have rules about when you leave your workstation, you have to lock your computer. I worked at a bank at some point, and that was one of the rituals there. We were the IT department. And if you forgot to lock your workstation, the other employees would go over and send an email to the entire team saying, hey, I'm buying pizza for everybody. And as the new guy, I did that a few times because I came from working at a hospital where I was the only guy in the data center. If I left my computer there for 5 hours, there would not be anyone else in there. But it is an excellent policy to have. And this was a good way to enforce it. Because after buying pizza for the third or fourth time, I got pretty good at it. I remembered to lock my computer when I left it. And then, of course, we need to make sure that our employees or whoever accesses our data uses strong passwords, multi-factor authentication wherever possible. We use masking and access control to ensure that only the people who are supposed to be in a certain place or on a certain application have access to it, and then we can enforce either need to know or least privilege. And we will cover these more in depth later. Need to know, you have access to more than you need, but you can only access what you need to know. This is used in role-based access control, where a network administrator, he or she gets access to all the routers and switches on the network, but they're only allowed to work on the ones where they have actual business. Or you can think of it as a doctor. They have access to all the patient files in the entire hospital. They can't just go looking around on patient records just to see what's going on. They have to be actively treating that patient. And then finally, least privilege. It is what it sounds like. We give the employees the least amount of privilege they need to do their job. If anything outside of that happens, if they need more access, then we need to grant it. And this is used in mandatory access control, which then brings us to integrity. And integrity and confidentiality are closely tied together. If one is not effective, the other one is not going to be either. If we're keeping our data completely secure in confidentiality, but someone can change it, well, then it's not viable data anymore. It's not usable. The other way around, if we have great integrity, but the confidentiality is breached, well, then the integrity might not matter either. The threats against integrity are very similar to the ones we had against confidentiality. Here, of course, since it's integrity, they're changing our data. And that could happen through code injections or attacks on our cryptography. And some of the things that we would use to prevent this are also similar to our confidentiality. We can use cryptography. We could use checksums or message digests or hashes. That could be an MD5 hash, a SHA-1 or 2 hash. It's basically an alphanumeric string where if you have a 100-page book, you get this output. That is the hash for that document. Now, if you change just one comma in that entire 100 pages, that entire hash is going to change. Same thing we do here. We have hashes on our data. You might also have seen it when you download things. This is the download file, and this is the hash that it should have. You can then hash the download, see if it matches what they have, and if it does, then assume that the data has not been altered. We could also use digital signatures, which can, if implemented right, can provide non-repudiation and access control. And you will see this trend throughout the course. Many of the countermeasures that we implement will be countermeasures that help with multiple things. And it does make sense. I mean, if we have strong access control on a database, well, then they can't come in and steal the data. They also can't alter the data. The biggest attack that I know of, where it was an attack on the integrity, was the Stuxworm. And I will go more in detail on that later. But basically, it was a worm developed by the US and Israel to target Iranian nuclear centrifuges to make them spin slightly faster. Not noticeable, just by 1 or 2%, but enough to break them at a much higher rate. Since all the systems in the Iranian plants were air-gapped, meaning there was no outside access, they infected hundreds, millions of systems. Until luckily, they infected the computer of one of the engineers who worked at the plant, who was foolish enough to take a USB drive with some pictures and brought them to work. Also, a big no-no. Since he then had the worm on the USB drive, it infected the centrifuges. In this case, the US and Israel did not care about the confidentiality. They knew everything about the centrifuges. Because they knew everything about them and everything about the programs, they could design an attack that only compromised integrity. And with that, let's move to availability. If you liked the video, please leave a thumbs up and remember to subscribe to the channel. To get my courses and the free study materials, click on Learn More. Thank you, and I will see you in the next video.